So what are case-based questions and why are they such an in thing, and why is everybody using them? So case-based questions are essentially questions which revolve around real-world problems. They pick problems that companies or products are facing in the real world, and they give you they present the problem to you and see how you go about solving it. So that's about it. And why they're so famous is because it's aimed at understanding how you solve real problems holistically, which is what you're going to do when you join the job. At the end of the day, nobody really cares what theory you know, what frameworks you know. What people care about is when you're given a real-world problem, how you're going to actually solve it. So that's why case-based questions work really well. And the other thing is because through case questions, you can test a lot of different things. So whether it's structured thinking in approaching the problem, creativity in solutioning, ability to deal with ambiguity, ability to prioritize solutions. I could go on and on, but I just said 360 degree of building products, and I stopped there. But essentially, like with a case question, I can test everything that is out there for you. And that is why all companies that I know of who have PM interviews make use of case-based questions. And it doesn't matter whether you're a fresher trying to join for an APM role or if you are a director of products, you will be asked a case-based question in the interview. With that, I'm going to go into what are the different types of case-based questions you'll see. This is again my list. I've got eight, four here and four in the next slide. This is based on what I have seen. In fact, the questions that I have here, the examples that I have here, are actually questions that either I have asked, or either I have been asked, or I know that my friends or my colleagues have asked. So these are real questions. And these have been asked. I mean, obviously, I wouldn't want to like tell you which company and when and which team and all, but these are questions that have been asked in the big tech companies. And when I say big tech, I mean the likes of Microsoft, Amazon, Google, Facebook, and across the world, and not just looking at India for this. So the different kinds of case-based questions you get. The first one I have is the product improvement question. So in this question, what you expect is you're given a product. Usually, it's a popular one because you need to know about it. And you're asked to improve that product in a certain manner. It could be different ways, but like a typical question could be something that we've asked, and I can like openly tell you about that is what would you do to improve Outlook? It's a very, very open-ended question. It's aimed at understanding how will you go about improving a product. Another very common question that's asked is what's your favorite product? One way that people take it is what's your favorite product and tell me why. Another way that people take it is what's your favorite product and suggest a couple of things that you would do to improve it. In fact, this question is asked so much that I would suggest that you should, if you're going into a PM interview, you should just practice this question. Like have a product in your mind which you want to talk about, which you know in and out, which you use enough, and think through already like what are a few improvements that you could do in it. So this is a very common question. In fact, I think every company just flat out asks this question. The next bucket we have is product design questions. These questions, basically what happens here is you are asked to design from scratch, usually a product for a particular market or with a particular goal in mind or for a particular customer. Couple of examples which I know have been asked. One is design a fire alarm system for deaf people. And another one is redesign Uber for kids. So what you can see here is basically we're taking a goal that you want to achieve and you're trying to build it for a particular segment of customers. So that's the product design question. The other set of questions are estimation questions. This is again very popular with product management companies. So the kind of questions you expect here are around guesstimates. How many trees are there in Delhi? How many taxis are there in Bangalore? These are a couple of questions that have been asked. Really testing out how comfortable are you working with guesstimates? How do you structurally approach a problem and break it down into solvable pieces? The next type of question is the analysis question. A couple of examples I have here are Netflix is seeing a drop in usage, but the revenue seems to be flat. What could be happening? How would you measure the success of Facebook likes? The example that Tamal gave, that would also probably fall under the analysis bucket. So here we're really looking at how do you deal with data and given a problem statement, which is focused around a metric, how do you go about building hypotheses for what is happening and how you could solve it. The next four buckets that I have the start off with product strategy. This is slightly, as the name suggests, is a strategic level question. It doesn't go into features and implementation and prioritization, but it talks about what should a company or a product do over a longer term. So a question like, what are top three things Instagram should do over the next 5 years to be the number one social media app? This is a question that has been asked. Or questions around growth hacking, like what's the next opportunity for LinkedIn to get 10x users? Or where is it going to get its next 10x opportunity from? So these are questions where you're expected to talk about strategy and mega trends and how the industry is moving and things like that. The next set of questions that I've seen is the build or buy questions. This probably is a little rarer. I haven't seen it being asked a lot, but there are a couple of companies out there who do ask this. Typical example is Facebook wants to enter the OTT space. What is its best option? Should it build one by scratch or should it buy out an existing player? Netflix wants to build a social graph. How should it do it? So these are questions that fall under the build or buy bucket. The next bucket is the technical bucket, and companies like, especially companies like Google and Facebook will definitely ask you questions from here. And a couple of examples here are, what are some cost-effective solutions that Google Meet can build to tackle the COVID surge? Or how would you go about launching GMAPs in a new city? So here, basically what the testing is, how comfortable are you with tech? I know a lot of you ask questions around how much tech should I know? I don't understand engineering. How do I go about appearing for PM interviews or preparing for PM jobs? And I think, although I'm not doing a deep dive into the technical case-based questions, but I think at some point when we do talk about this, I can shed more light on it. And the last bucket of questions that I have are the monetization questions, or probably you can call them the business-oriented questions. A couple of examples, what are some alternate ways for Spotify to monetize? What should WeWork do to turn profitable? Basically, here you're expected to take a business view of the product and the company, and suggest what are ways in which it can, you know, maybe add revenue or become more profitable and things like that. I'll cover a framework that you can use to answer in general product case questions. In fact, this framework works for product improvement, product design, analysis, estimation. Basically, anything that involves, you know, just talking about the product and how do you go about building or changing it. Before I go into the framework itself, for the folks who haven't done MBAs, so if you haven't done, if you haven't been introduced to frameworks, I shouldn't assume that people who don't do MBAs are not introduced to frameworks. If you haven't been introduced to frameworks, basically what a framework does is it's a tool which lets you think in a certain manner. So when you're given a problem, it lets you understand how do I approach this, and in the real world, where you're presented with problems which are very ambiguous and wide and general in nature, it really helps to have a framework to think along the lines of. Also, keep in mind that when you ask the case question, the goal really is not to see if you're giving the right answer, but the goal is to see how you are approaching the question. So it could be very possible that you're not employing a framework and you've come up with an answer either out of luck or out of, you know, just pure chance. But if you're not using a framework, if you come up with the answer, you are likely to not crack the interview. The goal of the case-based question is to see how you're approaching it, and therefore it really helps if you use a framework. Having said that, there is no, this is the right framework or this is the wrong framework kind of a thing. Here's a framework that I've used, which I find works really well for product case questions. You are free to use any framework you want. In fact, as long as you have a consistent, structured way of answering the question, you should be good. But it helps to use a framework like the Circles framework. So this was proposed by Lewis Lin. He's, I think, talked about this in his book, Decode and Conquer, a very nice book. I think I'd really suggest everyone reading that book. And one of the reasons why I like this framework so much is because it's very generic. What I've noticed is that the simple frameworks, the generic frameworks, are the ones that work really well because you can apply it to every situation. And the frameworks that are super specialized don't really work all the time. All right, so I'm going to quickly cover top mistakes made in case questions. And this is something that I've built from my experience. I have taken about, I guess, close to 50 interviews at Microsoft. And this is coming from my experience, and it's also sorted in order of what I see happening most frequently to least frequently. And this is also across all levels. So I'm also including freshers, all the way up to senior PMs who have started interviewing recently. So the number one mistake that I see people make, I would say about a quarter of interviews, I see this mistake being made, which is that people don't use a structure and they jump into a list of solutions. Despite the fact that it's really like it's almost common knowledge now that you should use a structure. A lot of people I see don't follow it. And there's a few reasons why this happens. You get, obviously there's an interview pressure, right? It's one thing solving this together with friends, but in an interview there's pressure. So it's easy to like forget a structure and just start listing out solutions. B, you could get, it could be like a googly question really, and you really don't know what to do and you end up solutioning. But whatever happens, don't do that. Always use a structure. The goal is not to arrive at the right answer. The goal is to approach the question in the right manner. So that's all you should be focusing on. The second mistake I see is not clarifying the question and assumptions. Like I spoke, I think in detail about how we clarified here, it's very important to clarify the question. These questions will always be open-ended and the interviewer is looking to decide on the scope along with you. And if you're not doing that, and if you're just assuming and going ahead, you could get off on a tangent that the interviewer does not want you to go on. The third one is not checking in with the interviewer from time to time. This is again a very big problem. What happens is if you have taken an assumption and you've gone ahead, you want to make sure that the path you are on is something that the interviewer is agreeing with, and always check in with the interviewer. It's okay to ask the interviewer. You can ask the person, does this sound okay, or do you want me to do something else? Right? That question is perfectly all right. It doesn't look like it's too, you know, invasive. It's perfectly fine to ask that question, and you should do that from time to time. Fourth one is not taking time to think. There are various steps in this. I think each slide, when I went on each slide, what you should ideally do is take 2 minutes and think. It's very hard for you to come up with customer segments or pain points off the top of your mind. And unless you have solved this earlier, there's no way you can do that actually. So take time to think, take a couple of minutes, start writing, jot down some points, and then talk. The other one is rambling incoherently. I like to put this because every now and then I get a candidate who has a lot going on in their head, but is unable to communicate. And therefore is just like, there's this huge mess of this weird train of thought that I'm really trying hard to catch on to. So that's another issue that I see. Not practicing cases enough. I've seen really smart people because they haven't practiced cases and, you know, like a particular industry or a particular product, or you can just see that they haven't practiced enough. And because of that, they've lost out. So that's another mistake. Not being creative enough. Sadly, I mean, I don't really, like, I can't give you tips on how do you not do this. I think the only way is, again, just practicing and being exposed to enough products and enough industries. That's one way to be creative. And at the end, like the least common mistake that people make is actually give a wrong answer. And when I say wrong answer, like a bizarrely wrong answer, like there is no such thing as a wrong answer for a case. But every once in a while, people give a very bizarre answer that probably will just not work in the real world. So, but I just want to call out that this is the least common mistake that people make. The more common mistakes are right up here. So if you can make sure you're not doing these, you are actually going to do well in a case interview.